with panelists from very different backgrounds, different places, to try and take the debate a little bit more to the regional and geopolitical level. And so, please, Randolph, and dear panelists, come to the table. So the panel is going to be moderated by Dr. Randolph Wallace-RHEA from the Peace Research Center for Peace Studies at the University of Tromsø in Norway. And participating to this panel, we have Dr. Nicu Popescu, from the EUISS, specialist in EU-Russia relations, Eastern Europe, South Caucasus, European Union foreign policy. Nicu Popescu has been a senior analyst at the EU Institute for International Security Studies since July 2013, where he specializes in Russia and the EU's eastern neighbors. He also teaches at Sciences Po Paris. He previously worked as an advisor on foreign policy and EU affairs for the Prime Minister of Moldova, where he dealt with a wide spectrum of foreign policy issues as well as domestic reforms, such as the visa liberalization process and Moldova's accession to the European Common Aviation Area. Prior to this, he worked as the head of program and senior research fellow at the European Council on Foreign Relations in London, and as a research fellow at the Center for European Policy Studies in Brussels. He holds a PhD in international relations from the Central European University in Bucharest. We have also Sarah Pagung, Dr. Sarah Pagung from the DGAP in Germany, Deutsche Gesellschaft für Auswärtige Politik. Sarah Pagung joined the Robert-Bosch Center for Central and Eastern Europe, Russia and Central Asia in December 2013. Her research focuses on Russian foreign and information policies and also on Moldova. In addition to this, she manages the discussion group on Russia and the Eastern Partnership and worked on behalf of the Carfilish Gardela colleague. From 2013 to 2015. We also have Dr. Laurent LEYLEKIAN. Who is an EU and South Caucasus expert, founder and CEO of Eunoos Public Affairs. Laurent LEYLEKIAN has been involved in South Caucasus policy analysis, especially in connection with the EU, for nearly two decades. From 2001 to 2010, he served as an executive director of the European Armenian Federation for Justice and Democracy, a Brussels-based NGO which advocates to strengthening the role and the positions of European citizens of Armenian descent in various European policies. In 2014, he founded Eunoos Public Affairs, a consultancy in public affairs advising policymakers on South Caucasus and Minor Asia. He notably recently publishes an article on water management issues in connection with the Azerbaijan-Karabakh dispute. Finally, we have Dr. Tatevik BIJOYAN. I'm going to say a word about that. We have Dr. I'll say a word about it in a minute. Dr. Tatevik BIJOYAN is coming from the National Research University at the Higher School of Economics in Moscow. She is a PhD candidate working on transformation of the Russian strategic culture in post-Soviet period and its influence on the security policy of the post-Soviet space. Her research focuses on security policy of the South Caucasus. She is currently managing the South Caucasus section of the project Human Faces of Conflict. And we have a question from the audience about the lack of Azerbaijani speakers here, if I understood properly. And indeed, we were supposed to have two Azerbaijani panelists, but for organizational reasons only, they could not make it today. And we've made sure to we are here without preconceived pro-Armenian position, and we hope that the audience, I know there are some Azeris in the audience, I hope that they will try to to raise the questions that they want if there is anything that's, that you don't like. So I ask everyone to have a respectful, not self-censored debate, but in respect and please don't capture the debate on very specific issues. Let the debate move forward.
Fascinating, having a big microphone in front of me. Thank you very much for that introduction, Morgan. That was fantastic. You've saved me a lot of work because I don't have to introduce the panelists now. And you introduced me as well. I'm so used to introducing myself also. I'm really excited to be here and to be invited by both the We Build Europe and the Caucasus Initiative to moderate this panel today. You know, in the last few years, I've focused my research and expertise more exclusively in the Great Lakes region of Africa, but my original kind of entry into research on conflict and politics and peacemaking and change really was originally in the South Caucasus in Georgian-Russian relations. So I'm always really excited to find an opportunity to come and participate in a forum on the region, and also always to learn as well, because it is fascinating, to say the least. So, you know, my hope here today is that we can have quite a productive and fluid conversation. You know, we have a large range of expertise, people coming from different backgrounds here, different focuses, and I think that that will allow us to hopefully have a conversation at quite at different scales. I think we can speak about certain local issues in some different areas in the South Caucasus. We can speak more regionally about the region as a whole, maybe at national levels, focus within specific countries. But I think we have enough expertise here and experience at the table that we can also explore some of the broader dynamics signaled in the title of the conference. That we can talk about EU-Russian relations, how those play out in South Caucasus, maybe also more broadly in the near abroad. If you like that term, and to explore some of these so-called zero sum issues, and you know I think the platforms and the opportunities for overcoming those. So I hope that can be the kind of discussion we have today. And I think I've coordinated with the panelists a little bit beforehand, and I think that everybody is interested in focusing on the productive issues. Yes, so maybe I can say a few words on format just before we get started. I've kind of arranged the discussion here into four themes, and I can give a brief introduction to each theme, and then I will open up the floor to each of the panelists to have to give a kickoff statement, if you will, to give them 2 minutes just to say what they think on that issue. To set the scene, and then we can open up for a bit more fluid exchange with the panelists here, where themes can be developed, panelists can react to each other, if there's a need to interject, I'll interject, but otherwise when I feel we're saturated or that it's a natural place to move on to the next theme, I'll come in and try to guide the conversation in that direction. So to give you guys just a little bit before I let you know the themes, I'd say questions. I really hope that the audience bring critical, insightful questions to the panelists here, but that you save them to the end. We have about 30 minutes scheduled for a question and answer session, and hopefully some really interesting conversation can come out of that. So note down your questions throughout the discussion here, and we'll make sure to get through as much of that as we can. Yeah? So the way I've thought about the conversation here, as I mentioned, is in kind of four things. The first thing, we can talk a little bit about the state of affairs. What are some of the key issues in the South Caucasus and in the near abroad today? And then the next theme beyond that, I think of as about interconnectivity, interrelatedness, about how do these themes fit together into some larger blocks, some larger issues. And you know, that part of the conversation is kind of about identifying the challenges. And I hope that after that we can move on to, okay, what are the opportunities for cooperation and opportunities and platforms to overcome these kinds of challenges. So I think that first we can explore kind of some of these zero-sum issues, and then maybe a more explicit discussion about pathways forward. So if I just, you know, jump back to this idea on the state of affairs, I think this is a chance for each of you to set a little bit the kind of issues you want to put on the map here of the discussion right at the outset. You know, what is important? What if you have to pick, you know, maybe two issues that you think are key to your understanding of abroad and maybe EU-Russian relations. And I realize that those distinctions may not always be clear. Some of these challenges may exist at different scales. So I invite you to, you know, to explore all kinds of issues, whether we're talking about security and territorial integrity, or whether it's something more broad about EU-Russian relations, or maybe even, you know, the role of other actors in the region, such as Turkey and Iran. So I'm going to stop talking. I'm the one who, you give me an audience and a microphone, and I'll talk forever. So hopefully I'll do much less of that, and maybe we can just start in the same direction.
Okay, I think, you know, we'll zoom in more once we talk about it, but I think what is pretty, it's worth noticing is the way this region has been divided for the last 25 years, but now you get this kind of geopolitical divisions on this region. So now you actually, from either EU or Russian perspective, you have a situation where in a region with three countries which are internationally recognized, you also have three type of trading block arrangements. You have Georgia being part of a free trade area with the EU. You have Armenia, which is part of the Eurasian Union, and you have Azerbaijan, which is bound and, you know, insists on playing a game that is independent from any type of alienation with our trading blocks. And, you know, how do you get out of this? How do you relaunch a regional kind of slightly more cooperative dynamic is not very clear, because these kind of divisions only get more and more entrenched. One thing I would be curious to look at is how the whole Chinese Belt and Road Initiative might impact that. Of course, that keeps Armenia aside for purely geographic, infrastructural, but also political reasons. But you know, one of the kind of news I would be following in the next months is what happens. And you know, Georgia now has a free trade area with the EU, and they are negotiating a free trade area with China. And yeah, I would be curious to see how that works. Obviously, that's an attempt to position yourself as a kind of mini mediator in this, in one of the biggest trade relationships in the world, which is the EU and China. So that would be something which I would keep an eye on. And of course, there would be, Armenia is excluded from this dynamic, but it's part of the Eurasian Union China dynamic, and let's see how, you know, that's another kind of set of question marks that are new to the region, and they slightly go beyond this constantly replayed intra-regional hostilities and mistrust, but also this old story of what is the EU doing and what is Russia doing, and we've been replaying it for so long that I'm in search for new question marks.
Thank you. Hi, I'm very glad to see you here. So I guess I won't be opening, like, discovering America if I'd say that security issues in this region is of first importance, of course, and included but not limited to energy and economic security as well. And of course, I'd outline the second problem is not always overlapping or coinciding interests of the three countries of the region, and including three unrecognized states, and the three regional powers, which creates some kind of difficulties in smooth and prosperous development of the region. This is it, I guess. Thank you.
No, I think that's two very interesting issues flagged right at the start, right? We have trade and trade issues, and then also related security, you know? Be that, you know, physical security, but also energy and economic security that you mentioned.
So, first I have to say that I probably cannot take the credits for having a doctor. I'm still in my process. Just to let you know that I won't take the credits for it, but hopefully soon. So, So I just have like 2 points. The first one a bit corresponding with what Nico just said. So we have like the US-European-Russia relations. I don't like to call it Western-Russian relations because I have a bit of problem with the term of Western. But like these relations are not the root of the conflict or its origin, but they're basically one of the big reasons why they look how they look today. So it's kind of, if you talk about the relations between the separatist entities and these states, it's like the elephant in the room, it's always there. And just to give you a glance at it, maybe like twin sister, because that's more like my area of expertise, we had the Cossack Memorandum in 2000 of this conflict, and you and USA really like pushed Moldova not to sign it. On the other side, Russia is like financing probably about 7% of the financial budget of Transnistria. So obviously, without Russia, Transnistria like wouldn't exist. So that's maybe an example how you can see it. But this kind of power struggle is also true for the more regional level. So we have a status quo in all of these regions, and there are strong vested interests in preventing this status quo. You have the elites in the like countries, which maybe tend not to invest resources. They want to use these resources in another way. And you also have the elites of the separatist entities who just don't want to lose their power. That's just basically it. And of course you have part of criminal networks who just gain profit or just profit out of the not defined or not clear status of these entities. So yeah, that's basically it.
So thank you to give me the floor too. I have to be short probably because the other speakers have been very short, and I forecast to make some long comment, but I will restrain myself to the first point. I will have time, yeah. So you asked us initially about the commonalities in the region. So maybe the most striking point is the lack of regional integration of those three republics, most of the states. And when you look at the figures, connected to, they are not so badly connected to the other countries, but not between themselves. even in globalization, they are not so well connected when you look at. But oil, for the other goods or services, they're not so connected. The other point which is striking is that Russia is everywhere in the three countries, and not only in Armenia, they are also in Azerbaijan, they are also, not politically, but economically, and also when you look at the weapon market, Russia is everywhere. So Russia is for sure an unavoidable actor of the region. And the last point I'd like to initially raise is that more between the EU and Russia is at deadlock today in many fields, and especially in the South Caucasus. So Nico mentioned China and the Chinese denied momentum in the region, but there is also the revival of Iran. And I think that the Iranian factor could in the future become when we think we keep in mind that these areas were some former Iranian province too. So that's probably a point to cope with in the future.
Thank you very much. No, I think that's fantastic. We had identifying trade, security. A common theme between a few of these was, of course, all of them, was the confrontation between the West, the EU, and Russian interests in the region. And then also, I like, very interestingly, the lack of regional integration. These countries are right next to each other physically, but as far as their connectivity, politically and economically, they may be quite separated compared to their physical position. I think right now, anybody wants to, any of the panelists want to react, anyone wants to develop some themes further, there's space to do that here. We can keep this as fluid as we like, and so does anybody have any points they want to bring up right now, any directions they want to go in developing some of these ideas about identifying challenges in the region? Yeah. One thing that I'd like to invite each of you to kind of engage in very specifically is to talk about the ways in which these issues are interrelated, interconnected, right? In that we tend to talk about, you know, all of you said, right, that the Russian-EU dynamic can be superimposed onto every issue, or maybe that every issue can be subsumed under that. But can we think a little bit differently about the kind of blocks of issues that exist in the region? You know, are there common economic challenges that all these countries face? Are there common security challenges that can be rethought in a way that we can think about this more regionally, that we can focus on the, if you will, the agency of these three countries and, you know, the de facto republics as well in the region, and understand their interests and the challenges they face beyond the scope of just EU and Russia.
Maybe just a comment on that point. The region, the three countries are addressed by the EU through several tools and several bodies, such as the European Neighbourhood Policy, the Eastern Partnership, and also the Black Sea Cooperation, Parliament Assembly, or things like this. And it seems to me that the European Union, that's just an idea I would like to share with the audience. It seems to me that the EU is very much insisting on the establishment of rule of law, democracy, freedom of expression, and things like this. Of course, probably the EU is right to do so. But this incentive, these policies could be, lacking some incentive when compared to the true advantages proposed by Russia. In other terms, I'm not sure, I'd like to share very openly with you, is there any soft power policy possible without an hard power policy in the region? And that's probably a point to consider when we think about the EU policy in the region.
Any of you interested in reacting to that? It's a very interesting point.
So I have five reactions. So, wow, look, this thing with regional integration, frankly, I wouldn't overdo it. Partly because just 25 years ago, this what is today three countries, and several separate, right? So they are reacting to that. Second, it's pretty natural. If you look at the Balkans, intra-Balkans trade is very low. If you look at southern Mediterranean, intra-southern Mediterranean trade is very low, partly because these countries are producing the same thing and it's easier for them to export, you know, persimmon to the EU and strawberries then to each other. So part of it is really regional. They occupy the same market niches, they have the same type of corrupt, you know, badly governed economies, and when they manage to export something, they often are in competition to each other. And of course, the Azerbaijani energy trade. So we can spend a lot of time talking about regional integration and you know, but I don't think we'll get very far. Also, as the international community, even if we remove the kind of externally superimposed blockages, and there would be no common association agreements and no Eurasian Union, these countries would still be, you know, the way they are. So, to be frank, I don't think that's really a promising venue for spending our intellectual, but especially policy effort as you know, governments and foreign. What I think would matter is to, you know, do trade agreements. These things work, you know, do visa-free like you do it with Georgia, do visa facilitation with Azerbaijan and Armenia, and, you know, a lot of these things will be removed. Now when we speak about trade, I think, and hard power and Russian, I think if you just go onto the street, and we can be the biggest trading partner of all the South Caucasus states. The EU. You know, of all the post-Soviet states, only one has Russia as the biggest trading partner, and that country is Belarus. All the other post-Soviet states trade more with China, that's obvious, Central Asia minus Kazakhstan, and from Kazakhstan to Ukraine, for everyone, the EU is the biggest trading partner. Russia is within, and for most of the states, Russia has less than 20% of their external trade. For Georgia, it's 8-9%. For Armenia, it's in the order of 15%. Another kind of striking number that I ran into recently. We were all talking about this EU-Russia trade summit. Russia trade decreased by an impressive 36% in 2015. If you look at it, it's pretty dramatic. But in the same 2015, Armenian export to Russia decreased by the same amount as European exports to Russia. So actually, you have a situation where the EU and Russia exchange sanctions, and Armenia and Russia are part of the same union and the customs union, and they have exactly the same trade kind of decreasing statistics. Now, so I think a lot of these things happen beyond the geopolitics and the news, and and I'll also, have a part direction to you. You referred to de facto republics. And, you know, there was this this whole debate and, you know, this story of, you know, de facto states applied to Abkhazia and South Ossetia, Nagorno-Karabakh and Transnistria. But you know, this academic literature, you know, the founding father of this was Scott Pegg with his book from 1998 called De Facto States, where he applies the Montevideo Convention of 1933. So he called these regions de facto states. But to my mind, especially in the case of Abkhazia and South Ossetia after 2008, they are no longer de facto states. I think they no longer have, you know, as much for 2008 to decide what they want to do in terms of foreign policy, especially for South Ossetia. You know, this term is simply no longer correct. So it might be an academic term which is maybe cool to apply, but in reality, it doesn't reflect anymore, you know, the kind of lack of room for maneuver for Abkhazia or South Ossetia to do what they think they want to do in terms of, you know, how they pursue their external engagement. So I think de facto republics or states is simply a term that no longer applies to this. And it's very obvious why, right?
Maybe you can say a little bit more about if you have any idea, just explore the idea. How would you conceptualize their relationships now and their agency now? And if you could have some initial leaning on what to call that, if not as a fact of state.
Even if you want to measure it on things like, do they have a currency? They don't have a currency. You know, Transnistria has a currency and Abkhazia doesn't have. a currency, for example. So you can take, you know, 10 or 20 most important criteria of what you think makes a state de facto or not, and they mostly lack them. But what I think also happened was that they basically outsourced the running of several institutions that they more or less controlled. And of course, the recent agreement, you know, on the integration of the South Ossetian military into the Russian military is just the tip of the iceberg, but it's basically on several policy areas have been simply outsourced to Russia. So Russia is not simply, you know, transferring cash, but Russia, the Russian audit chamber is also verifying how the Russian taxpayers' money are spent in a party. And you know, the same goes on army. So, you know, yes, it's a secessionist region, if you want, under the heavy influence. I mean, these conceptual tools were there before the de facto statehood term was brought into the picture, right? So, I'm not sure to what extent we want to invent a new term. We shouldn't be. I think, it, you know, this kind of de facto state concept is simply no longer applies to them.
Great, there's a few people who want to follow up. I think that's really interesting to conceptualize that way and to point out the lack of kind of analytical clarity in the term and the way that there may be some nuances that aren't captured there. You were first, Sarah, and then
Laura. Yeah, okay, just like one comment on the de facto states. I think whether you call them de facto states or something different, we have to keep in mind their differences, because you can describe them all by one. We have like Transnistria striving for unification with Russia, which is constantly being denied by Russia. We have Abkhazia, which is accepted by Russia as its own country, not striving for reunification with Russia. And we have South Ossetia, which is like the third case, also like for reunification. So there are a lot of differences. But like, if it's okay, I just want to go back like one step, because of what you said about like trade concerning Russia EU policy approach. So I think we tend to overrate economy. We have like this huge trade amounts between the EU and all these states, but that doesn't transfer automatically into political leverage. So just taking like just Ukraine, like we have this huge economic partnership with Ukraine, but nevertheless, 2013, Russia was able like, to turn it the other way, so they denied the signing of the association agreement in the first instance. And also, but this also reflects a political approach you just mentioned of the European Union, because in terms of thinking of the European Union, political reforms, like rule of law, market freedoms, all that, they go hand in hand with economic development. You cannot have economic prosperity without these. So that's why, in the end, the European Union or partnership or European neighborhood policy is geopolitical or political, but it is because all those economic reforms go hand in hand with political rapprochement and in the end becoming a bit like the European Union. So you cannot, even though the European Union is denying that, it's just the way it is. And that's basically the problem Russia is having with it.
Pass the microphone to Tatevik here.
Yeah, thank you. I'll continue Sarah's consideration. Just saying that EU's attempt to like to impose something political on this region is like they're concentrating on these things like rule of law and so on. They're keep giving a lot of money to these governments, and these governments are using this money by their own consideration and discretion, which means that basically. They're going on not on their purpose. They're not doing whatever they should do. What are they aimed? So that means that Russian influence here is much more because all this rule of law, like civil movements, civil, like development of civil society is very good, but Russia is still is the main player in the region because he's controlled lots of things, including political, security issues, energy issues, and lots of what. And then I'm just wanting to go back to the integration issues. I think there is some room for integration in the region because, for example, the region and Azerbaijan are quite good in many spheres of like cooperation, as well as, for example, Georgia and Armenia. And of course, there is room for integration of, if not several security issues, and if not, for example, the which means that yes, we can't say that there is no integration prospects like for the whole region. It would be kind of wrong to me. But still, we have like problems that should be overcome to be like to have this integration have possible. Thank you.
About the notion of de facto states, and indeed the notion of state, you're probably right that those states are, their economy and their politics are very embedded with the, some hosting, other hosting states, for instance, Karabakh in Armenia, or Abkhazia with Russia, and so on. But is Greece today an independent state? The fact is that a weak country, which is in the global environment, is no more independent. And I would like to add also that maybe a way to think differently those so-called de facto states or non-internationally recognized states. We are always considering Abkhazia, South Ossetia, Kharabakh, and also Transnistria in the framework of the region. But on the one hand, some have been recognized and they are failed. We were talking about South Sudan, for instance, this is a true drama. And some others are not recognized and are success. I'm thinking about Taiwan. Taiwan today, Taiwan is not a recognized state at the United Nations, and it doesn't seem to be a problem for anyone, maybe for China. But but I want to say that if we keep on thinking about those countries and those also those de facto states in this Soviet post-Soviet framework, it is a little bit sterile.
No, I think that's a very interesting point, building on Nicu's original idea that the term de facto state, you know, doesn't capture the nuance of the flows of power, the room for maneuver or lack thereof, you know, that we tend to put in the traditional frameworks of what is a state, and seeing it through the post-Soviet lens. I thought one issue that we've heard just mentioned briefly, that I'd like to invite all the speakers really to comment on if they have any thoughts, is, you know, I've heard a few spots both Turkey and Iran mentioned, and while the broader confrontation between, you know, EU capturing maybe a lot of the trade policy in the region and maybe Russia capturing a lot of more military or security-related policy in some areas of the South Caucasus, do any of the panelists have any reflections on the role of any other powers in the region, namely Turkey and Iran or others?
First, Turkey and Iran have immense influence on the region. For example, not speaking about Iran, but Turkey, which is the main, which has crucial and critical relationship with Azerbaijan. I mean, Azerbaijan is leading more or less independent policy toward Russia and EU and wherever, but still it has really close ties with Turkey. And of course they are influencing each other, and which was quite obvious in 2008 when it was so-called football diplomacy between Armenia and Turkey, and we were trying to like open each other's borders, although it was borders on the side of Turkey. And Azerbaijan was was fiercely against this because the opening of the borders between Armenia and Turkey means that it is an economic prospect for Armenia and the prospects for the development, which was against Azerbaijan's interest, obviously. So it means that and Turkey, of course, followed this like interest of this country. And because one of the preconditions for opening the borders was, of course, the resolution of Karabakh problem, which was, of course, getting back all the territories, controlling territories of Armenia, the unknown status of Nagorno-Karabakh within the borders of Azerbaijan, and so on and so forth, which is, of course, unacceptable by Armenia. This is it, I think.
No, the most valuable Georgian export to Turkey has been Erdogan's grandfather, who was a Lazi, who is a Georgian, a Kartvelo speaking Turk, a Jaka who spoke Georgian. So, anyway. Look, I think, by the way, generally Turkish foreign policy has evolved in the last 5-6 years. It doesn't look like they have more room for maneuver to influence the region. I think what happened in the last 5, 6, 7, 8 years, the Turks had more influence at the time but less ambition, and now they seem to be having more ambition but less influence. And you know that kind of funny but sad catchphrase that, you know, the Turks started with a policy of zero problems with neighbors. And today they have a situation where like, zero neighbors without problems. And that's quite true, you know, not all of it is their fault. And, you know, irrespective of what Turkey could or could not do. But definitely, you know, they are no longer, in foreign policy terms, you know, the beacon of attraction and influence. And even in soft power terms, I remember all that wave of articles. Spring, you know, will the Egyptian Muslim Brotherhood become like the Turkish AKP, and all that is completely gone, you know, with the realities. So we might have a situation where Turkish ambitions are higher, you know, the desire to instrumentalize foreign policy for domestic grandeur is higher, the noise coming from the part is higher, but in reality they no longer have the economic power, the soft power, the domestic stability, the domestic consensus to be you know, where they were vis-a-vis Syria or even the South Caucasus, where they were 7-8 years ago, when they were much bigger and more attractive as a... So we'll see what happens, but of course what we read in daily news in Turkey, it doesn't look...
Just support what has been said. I'm not sure that today, maybe in comparison with a few days ago, a few years ago, Turkey is very happy with the influence of the Azerbaijani dispute with Armenia and Karabakh on its own policy and politics. And it was probably different a few years ago, in the thousands, there was an attempt to relocate some Meshkatian Turks in Armenian populated region of southern Georgia along to the pipelines. And it was seen as a potential threat both by those Armenian local population of Georgia and also maybe by Armenia. And the truth that today this kind of policy is still enforced or supported by Turkey. I would like to say on that kind of point that when it comes to the instrumentalization of refugees, the idealistic policy of the EU is not so idealistic also. For instance, at least for the, seen by Russia, for instance, there are some supports from the EU to the refugees or to the local development in Abkhazia or in Ossetia or even in some other areas which are the discussion. But there are not this kind of support in Karabakh from the EU. So there could be some Armenian perspective against this so-called idealistic policy, which is not so idealistic.
Thank you.
Is there any kind of final comments from any of you on what's been said so far before I kind of direct it another way? Go ahead, sir.
Just for everyone, like, I basically agree with what Nico just said. I just sometimes wonder if the analyses of internal instability or maybe a lacking of resources really leads to more passive foreign policy. So seeing Turkey in transformation or transition to a more authoritarian, okay, I don't get the word, country, yeah, I don't repeat it again, it's going to be embarrassing. And so that means that maybe the foreign policy is going to be even more risky and not really accountable. So I don't know if that really, like, short term maybe, but midterm really leads to like a more passive or stabilizing foreign policy.
Yeah, I said more ambitious, which meant more proactive. So I must have expressed myself way too clear cut, but I said more ambitious.
Good. So far, I think we've had a quite fluid conversation. I didn't even feel like I really needed to interject and to reset the second theme, you know? We've had an opportunity to lay a lot on the table and to start talking about how some of these issues are interconnected, whether we're talking about Eurasia, whether we're talking about the specific internal dynamics of each of the Caucasus countries and their breakaway regions, whether we call them de facto states or something else. You know, we talked about trade capture by the EU. We've talked about the role of other players in the region. And so, you know, we, you know, in the title of the, or kind of the main questions in the flyer here that you guys probably have read on this conference, there's this theme of zero-sum issues. And there's this idea in the way that we talk about the South Caucasus, a lot of the, if you will, the post-Soviet space or the near-abroad or whatever you want to call it, that there is a set of intractable issues there. But it sounds like there's a lot more nuance in some of the dynamics in the region and in these spaces. And I want to invite each of the speakers, we can kind of reset to focus on kind of challenging this idea of zero sum in the region. You know, what are the roadblocks? You know, what stands in the way? I want to invite the panelists to think, I hope, quite speculatively and maybe even creatively about what kind of solutions could exist in the region. You know, if we kind of suspend our all the technicalities and think about what are the things that need to happen in the region to promote the interests of the region more broadly. You know, what are those agendas? And so we can think about what should the agendas be forward. And maybe this time we'll start on the other end of the table.
I really don't know what could be the agenda. My feeling is that, to be honest, my feeling is that the EU has no independent foreign policy in the region. And this foreign policy is overruled by security consideration and NATO consideration with the US. And the paradox is that today the USA are probably less dogmatic and more pragmatic than the EU in the region. And so the US policy is progressing in the region despite some possible dispute with the EU is stuck to the current situation and because of some involvement with some global security issue in connection with NATO. I don't know if our policy leader or policymakers will be able to get out from this trap. My feeling is that maybe what could be the Chinese factor in the region. My feeling is that the Iranian factor could bring something, because I see a kind of possible synergy between Russia and the EU on Iran. You know that today, as far as I know for a long time, Iran is an ally of Russia, and a gateway, Russia could need this kind of gateway to Iran through the South Caucasus. And in the same time, the EU would like to reach the Iran market, and so, of course, that's just ideas, but and so some possible synergy could arise in, in this framework. And maybe it could relaunch EU-Russia initiative in the region, which would get away from this.
Okay, unfortunately, I didn't have the solution either, but I think if anybody would have, he would probably have a really good contract, I don't know, with one of the big governments. Just a comment on that zero-sum game. I think we always have to keep in mind that the zero-sum game is what we make out of it. It's like, it's not there by nature, but it's actually the perception of the stakeholders. So what we have to do is to overcome that. And I think the main obstacle in overcoming this perception is the lack of trust. We don't have any trust neither between the EU and Russia or the US and Russia, and also that accounts for like every conflict and its size. And so the problem is that you can't reach even small agreements, because one side is overthinking, okay, the other side is not sticking to what we've agreed on. So that's basically the problem. Trust building measures. And I think identifying those possible areas for trust building is what we're all like searching right now for, because it's so hard. We still have some things which are in the region where we are working, like for example the Open Skies Agreement, but we have other things, especially in security, like the Vienna documents, which are not working. So we need to work on that, but to be blunt, I'm very pessimistic that will happen short or even midterm. I think that's a long-term question, a long-term challenge we have to scope. And I also think that it won't be possible with the current Russian leadership.
Two very interesting issues flagged there as the kind of roadblocks forward, right? We talk about first, Laurent mentioning foreign policy in the region, especially EU foreign policy being stuck, and the role of possible kind of wild cards like China and Iran relationships that might develop there. And then Sarah, you mentioning, of course, the very interesting truth that zero-sum dynamics are merely perceptual, right? And that trust may be one of the big factors behind that, or lack thereof. And so trust-building measures, how to achieve that practically, becomes a very interesting question that is, of course, extremely challenging, extremely complex. I'll just keep moving forward.
This time I want to do it with my colleagues, because for me, for example, what do I understand by zero-sum games? It means that one society is getting advantages of the other society. So, I think we are getting too much, we are paying too much attention to EU and Russia influence on this region. Of course, obviously they have this influence. But as one of the experts on South Caucasus says, that South Caucasus is not a chess test. It's like a word domino. Like these three countries have their own policy, like it or not. For example, when Armenia was pushing its agreement with opening the borders with Turkey, Russia was not happy, but still it can do anything with this because Armenia is letting its own policy. The same is, for example, in the case of Nagorno-Karabakh. Like, of course, we are seeing that Russia is having. Trust me, the key to the resolution of this problem is in Baku and in Armenia, in Yerevan. So it's between us, basically. And if we want to change this into some situation, I think it's going to take some long-term steps. we need to change our society, we need to change our perceptions, yes, sorry, I agree with you, and to show that we are not enemies. Basically, our project here on Faces of the Conflict aimed to help to understand that we are not only enemies, we are all people, we are living in the same region, and we should not kill each other because of the territory. Of course, it is important, but still, we should change our perception on ourselves, and it's going to happen over time. Like, it's not going to happen now, because we have extremely provocative governments in Azerbaijan. I'm sorry, it is true. We have some difficulties in Armenian government as well, because it is not ideal as well. In Georgia, I see some kind of positive steps, because they are understanding that they lose, unfortunately, these two territories, Abkhazia and South Ossetia, and they are going forward. They are trying to go forward. Maybe I'm wrong, but this is my vision of the situation. Thank you.
Listen, on a number of things. With zero-sum discussion reminded me of an old Caucasian joke, which I hope will be equally offensive to. There is this Armenian kid who comes to his grandfather and says, "Grandfather, if we Armenians are the greatest nation in the world, why didn't we fly into the space like the Americans and the Russians do?" So, "Oh, kiddo, of course we could fly into space if we would want to. We are the greatest nation. But you know, if we'd fly into space, then all the Georgians would die of envy. And if all the Georgians die of envy, all the Armenians will die of happiness with all." And we cannot leave the South Caucasus to the Azeris. So, you know, presumably the joke has migrated in one form or the other for quite some time, you know, and I won't try to overcome. But, you know, I think when we speak of a zero-sum story, we should not talk about a zero-sum story in the region. There is a lot of cooperation between Armenia and Georgia, and Georgia and Azerbaijan. It's just an Armenia-Azerbaijan story to a large extent. You know, at some point, Georgia is doing a lot of transit into Azerbaijan. You know, most Azeri cars come through Georgia. There is Azerbaijani energy which saved Georgia. You know, there is a lot of stuff happening, and all the transport corridors and the pipelines and the trade transit. And you get a bit of the same with the Armenia Georgia, right? You know, and who is the biggest? Who are the biggest tourists in Batumi? You know, the Iranians and the Armenians. Zero sum, and it's not totally disrupted. There's an Armenia kind of Azerbaijan cleavage which casts a shadow on the entire region, but it's not that, you know, there is no regional cooperation and everything is zero sum. There's lots of it which is not zero sum. And you know, the EU interest in the area and Russia, I'd say two things. One, if I look at what the EU and Russia wanted in the region a decade ago, and what they got today, I'd say achievements, but both of them massively failed. I think that for the EU it worked reasonably well in trade promotion. There are some regional successes, you know, like for example, we did a study, we compared basically how these neighboring states of the EU did in the last 10 years, and we just took, you know, corruption perception index, Freedom House Index, Reporters Without Borders, and we traced them. And actually, some of the stories are really good, like on cost of doing business, all of these states have massively improved in the last 10 years. On corruption perception, they did improve. Armenia and Azerbaijan have been better on cost of doing business than Moldova and Ukraine, for example. You know, there are some. I don't think it's thanks to the EU, but not everything is better, not everything is worse in this region. Now, in pure geopolitics, you mentioned Russian hard power, and to be frank, I'm not very convinced the Russians got what they wanted in most, not just the region, but also in a country like Ukraine. So I think the EU didn't get a lot of what it wanted, but the Russians haven't been terribly successful either. Despite their visibility, despite their knowledge of the region, which is often deeper, but it didn't serve them well. And you know, you might have, you know, integrate with South Ossetian army and the Abkhaz army into the Russian army, but if it loses to Georgia for, you know, 2-3 generations, we can discuss about how successful is that. The same goes for Ukraine. You know, Azerbaijan has been holding its complementary foreign policy quite successfully. And to me, you know, everyone talks about Armenia, you know, the U-turn Armenia took on September 1st in 2003 when Sarkisian and Putin went into a discussion room and came up 2 hours later with hyper-stressed faces and said, you know, Armenia is not going to sign the association agreement. Which everyone says, you know, oh, this terrible kind of Armenian U-turn. But if I think about it, it's like, I'm really surprised the Russians haven't persuaded the Armenians like a year ago before that not even to negotiate the association agreement. So imagine actually what a kind of degree of self-confidence the Armenian had to launch associations, to finalize them. It didn't work in the end. But the degree of kind of diplomatic challenge this was to Russia, you know, the Russians have been sending the signals not to do that to the Armenians well before. And, you know, with all the Russian hard power, the Armenians actually went all the way. They couldn't make the final jump, right? But that was pretty striking. And on this, I think, you know, Putin was even more irritated. If you actually look at the video of this conference, you know, Putin was as irritated as Sarkisian by the previous 2 hours. Because it is irritating for Putin to spend 2 hours persuading Armenia not to sign the association agreement, right? But you know, imagine you're Putin, you're the most influential person on the Time magazine cover, and Armenia negotiates, concludes the negotiations, and then you have to really twist their arms not to sign. That's, you know, I wouldn't be very reassured. Now, on what the EU does, to be frank, you said that the EU is not an independent player, but I don't see on which policies France or Germany or the EU would so massively differ from the United States so as to censor themselves? So what policy goals can we have in the region that so massively differ that we would be concerned with the Americans preventing us from doing that? I really don't see. Of course, the most dramatic thing that happened, and that the Americans did not overrule, is the French and German veto of NATO expansion in 2008. But that, if anything, shows the independence of the French and German line. So, you know, the most dramatic thing, actually, the Europeans had, well, France and Germany at the time had their way against America. What I see, however, is a lot of European self-censorship in policies where the Europeans were not doing things in order not to upset and irritate Russia. So in the 90s, there was a conscious choice by the EU not to get involved in the separatist conflict in the region and to leave it to the OSCE and the UN, because we don't want to do anything there. It was a conscious choice, not because of America, but because, you know, that was the policy, and the Balkans were more than enough. Throughout the 2000, the year 2000, the EU tried to get and become a mediator in South Ossetia first. It tried to finance some projects in South Ossetia, but then the Russian South Ossetia said, no, we don't want you as a mediator, and the EU accepted that. The most dramatic, you know, what if side of history for me came in 2005, when Russia vetoed the OSCE border monitoring mission in Georgia. The border mission was basically killed, Russia vetoed the budget, so there were no longer monitors on the Russian-Georgian border. Georgia, at the time, invited the EU to take over the monitoring mission. I think it was something like 200 monitors. And the EU basically decided not to do that because it thought it would be too provocative against Russia and it would irritate Russia. So the EU sent 3 border assistance personnel to Tbilisi, which was a way to say no. Now, I still believe that if in 2005 the EU would have sent 200 people on the ground, we would have avoided the 2008 war. Because neither Georgia nor Russia would have behaved in ways which were as conducive to the war in the presence of 200 European monitors with all the diplomatic pressure and attention that comes to it. Because God forbid, you know, imagine on the night of the 7th, a German or a French monitor would have been killed by accident. They wouldn't be on the Ossetian border, but they would be on the Russian border. So I think, you know, this is one instance where the EU did not go as a monitoring mission in 2005 because we didn't want to irritate the Russians. We ended up with a war, and 3 years later we deployed 200 monitors called as the EU monitoring mission. So we ended up doing it. But if we did it before, you know, it's purely speculative. We don't know that. But my belief is that the chances of avoiding that war would have been greater.
Kind of by way of conclusion, I'd ask each of you to speak a little bit about if you think about this whole conversation, we've been quite focused on problems. What are the platforms that exist now that you think are promising or playing a meaningful role, or that can play a meaningful role in the future? You know, for example, if we talk about EU foreign policy and that it needs to be maybe be less censored or maybe play a more active role, okay, how to actualize that, how to make that happen? If we talk about trust building, you know, this is a very difficult question. All of these are difficult questions. You know, what are some platforms for trust building that you think exist or have potential to have positive impact in the future? You know, if we talk about bilateral relationships, about the importance of Armenia and Azerbaijan speaking to each other and resolving territorial disputes, you know, how can we encourage, what platforms exist to encourage us? And I think just because you just had a few minutes there.
It's not really a gift. Well, I don't know what could be those platforms. What I think is that, of course, that's a very common idea. There is a strong correlation between the poor level of democracy, globally speaking, and the mistrust between those nations. Personally, it seems to me that initiative gathering journalists, for instance, and there have been this kind of initiative, and Armenian journalists could help people to share their experience on unusual life, you know, and criticism, how to constructively criticize the authorities, how to point out the various lacks of democracy, and this exchange could be interesting to push forward and foster. Another point also could be the level of local democracy. Those countries are very centralized, have been very centralized. There have been and there are some true successes in regional bodies, institutions, authorities. Sorry, and I think that we could maybe imagine some level of technical cooperation between some regional entities, especially with Georgia, because Georgia has a wide variety of ethnic composition of people, and they. That could be an end. Georgia could be once to start, could be the gateway between the Azerbaijani and the Armenian. I have to say that, and that's not an offense, that those countries are not so democratic, but Azerbaijan is the most authoritarian of the three, and I don't think that today. Even in Armenia, by the way, but even worse in Azerbaijan, the local authorities are so independent and could raise this kind of local crisis.
Okay, I have two comments. First, taking it back to the broader picture, leaving it to Tatevik to comment on the more details of the Southern Caucasus. What I think is that finding the platforms or the platforms itself, for example, the organizations or the problem itself. So we have, for example, the OSCE, which is like, by definition, the organization for conflict management. But what we see is that while Europe is perceiving these organizations as a solution, it's perceiving it as the root or the problem. We basically have a deadlock. And we are again at the point of trust building measures. So what we do actually is circling and circling and circling, coming back to lack of trust, and we'll end up at the beginning again. And what I wanted to do is a much more like detailed one. So Tatevik already mentioned the project Human Phases of Conflict. So that's maybe a good example for civil society engagement you already talked about. So if there's, or Tatevik already said that we have to change the perception of zero-sum games, of enemies, of just like this confrontation between societies and the governments. So, and that's something that has to come out of the civil society. I know that it's like a deeply European approach, but I'm personally pretty convinced that it's the only way to do it. So, for example, the Human Phases of Conflict project is about talking to people and interviewing them who experience the conflict. It's also like human and can be nice and can be helpful, and if you're in danger, just helps you. And I think that's a small scale, and it will take years, and it will take like, we just should start, and that's also like where we're coming back to the broader picture, because making those civil society projects possible is about building up civil society, and that's a huge problem in the post-Soviet space as a whole, because there we don't have these civil society, like we have a kind of a Europeanization of the post-Soviet space, which would oppose Russia. So as you see, we're again circling and coming back to it.
I think these are two very interesting points of view to start off, you know, focusing on the importance of, said with the caveat, of course, that we were coming from a very European perspective here, right? That's an important framing to have. But that at least here in this part of the world, we tend to think about the challenges in the region, about democracy, about civil society, about perceptual problems, about that the importance of civil society and grassroots measures for finding a sense of legitimacy in the change that happens in the region. I think very interesting starting points. I'll pass the microphone further.
Yeah. Well, I don't know whether like Sarah's described method would help in some real political games, but on individual level, it's really going to help. And I can bring my own example. When I learned about those Azerbaijanis who saved Armenians during the Baku and Sumgayit pogroms, like it completely. Recently, we had an interview with one of the journalists whose mother, they were living in Azerbaijan in 1990s, whose mother was saved by Azeri woman, Azeri family. And he's saying that lots of Azeri families were saving their Armenian neighbors, suffered as well. So of course, I don't know, it's going to help on like real political, on the global level, but of course it's changed our attitudes on individual level. And maybe this is a first step.
This is a first step towards some resolution of the conflict.
Thank you.
Yeah, it's a very good question. Look, I think basically we have this, what we've learned is that you integrate coal and steel, and Germany and France come together. And we're building this hyper happy union called the European Union, which lasts for 70 years and everything's great. And that really, it worked. But it doesn't, it doesn't always work. And I think one of the most striking counter dynamics, if you ask me, is the EU-Russia relationship. For the last 10 years, the highest number of Schengen visas in the world are issued in Russia. So 40% of Schengen visas are issued in Russia. The number of Russian students you are in an university environment, you know better than how many dozens of thousands of Russians study in the EU, how many of them travel to the EU for trips. EU trade with Russia in the last 10 years increased 400-500%, It's massive, these numbers are incredible, and yet, the more we traded, the more we exchanged civil society and student contacts, the worse the political relationship became. Why we can discuss, but So if I kind of look at it and I say, I'm really in favor of having more exchanges between Armenia and Azerbaijan, and you know, maybe we'll arrive to a situation where people annually will be, you know, exchanging. But that is nowhere near the magnitude and the scale of things we need to do. And to be frank, I don't, you know, something needs to be ripe in the region itself. And it's not Europeans teaching and going there and say, oh, by the way, regional integration and forget about zero sum, you should learn to be post-nationalist. I don't think this will work, it only mostly irritates. On the positive side, I read recently an interview by Aleksandar Vučić, the newly re-elected elected president of Serbia, in Politico. Read it, it's amazing, you know. He says that, well, you know, we had this war, but now it will take some time to do, and we need economic growth now. So I'm really supporting trade liberalization in the Balkans. I really want us to build the value chains so that we, with the Albanians and the Macedonians, produce something which is competitive for Europe. So at some point, this element will arrive, but it's all his other faults. Vučić is today saying, I want regional integration because I want slightly more economic growth, and I am going now to my neighbors and I'm going to persuade them, we're all working on trade integration. But with South Caucasus is nowhere near that. On the contrary, I think now Armenia and Azerbaijan and Georgia are the beginning of a new dynamic. It's the association agreement, and the Georgians have 10 years to implement it. We'll see how it goes. And the Armenians have a new thing called the Eurasian Union. Armenia still has to negotiate its revision of tariffs in the WTO. So Armenia is really very early into its Eurasian experience, and Georgia is early in the association experience. And I think we need a few years for them to see what works, what doesn't, before we really talk about opening up a bit. Because now everyone is not that they look in different parts, they are going there. And they need to hit some walls before they arrive to a Vučić stage. So I think, you know, us going and lecturing is not going to help. Let's work hard. Implementation. Let's save as much as possible from the relationship with Armenia. And that's, you know, a task to do. It will take years to do that. And let's, you know, work on doing as much as possible with Azerbaijan. You know, if Azerbaijan will decide that it's the moment to join the WTO, but it needs to reinvest more into a post-oil economy. You have this debate inside Azerbaijan. You know, and then I think if these states evolve in 4 or 5 years, we could have this conversation. But I think at this stage, everyone is just not simply looking, but walking in different directions. And I don't think our words would have much of an impact in making them rethink a little bit as to what their current strategies are.
I think that's actually a very good kind of concluding comment on the discussion here. You know, in this last part of the panel, when we're talking about some of the platforms forward, one of the very interesting themes I hear, not explicitly said by anyone, but an undercurrent in everyone's final comment here, was patience. That, you know, maybe we aren't where we thought we would be, whether that's from if we say the EU, or we if we say Russia, more importantly, with the three countries in the region. You know, even if we aren't where we thought we would be 10 years ago today, there is progress in the region, and there's going to continue to be progress in the region in a lot of ways. And, you know, I think there needs to be a level of patience in approaching very complex, subtle, and abstract issues like trust, perceptual issues about change, personal relationships, you know, the way that, you know, continuing trade will change the region, the way that that these issues will evolve over time. You know, forces, for example, you know, when you talk about how much of Russia is being educated in the EU now. These kinds of broader changes will eventually that will turn out, but it's going to definitely be something different than what it is now. So we've started spilling over into some of our question time. So I'm not gonna speak much more here now. I want to take a moment just to thank all the panelists here. And then to open the floor to questions and comments from the audience.
The director of Caucasus Initiative, you. I mean, my question would be for Nicu Popescu. It's something that's more geopolitical than usually, because I know that you're a huge fan of the Eurasian Economic Union, in a certain way, at least you're working on it. And my question would be like, do you think that it could be possible to integrate Abkhazia inside the Eurasian Economic Union, which will avoid some or another Crimea? It's quite simple. And as a consequence, it led to many embargoes. But with the Eurasian Economic Union, maybe it's a way to integrate Abkhazia and avoiding to integrate it inside the Russian Federation. And at the same time, it will be somehow de facto integrated in the same currency, the same army, or all other aspects of the society. So what do you think of this potential strategy, or Russian strategy, regarding the Eurasian Economic Union in Caucasus?
Fantastic, very specific question. I like it. Maybe we can collect one or two more, and then open up for a little bit of discussion up here.
Yeah. No, I'm just taking a comment about just not a civilization issue of human being, which has been so.
Is it an ideological issue?
Yeah, ideological issue. Just to reorganize everything that you can see everywhere. I don't know.
Any other? Yeah, you there? Be sure to speak up clearly.
Okay, I'll try. I've got a question concerning the international law. To know the Armenian side concerning this question, what is the position of Armenia concerning one of the fundamental principles of United Nations, which is territorial as we know, the United Nations actually consider the occupied territory as a part of Azerbaijan Republic. So, would you suggest that there is a kind of hierarchy of principles on the international law? How do you explain this, just your position concerning this question? That's it.
Very good. I think that those are some meaty topics there. So I'm going to pause the intake of questions for a moment. And the first question was directed to you specifically, Nicu. So do you want to start with talking about the Eurasian Union?
Actually, I brought a few copies. I put them there, so if you're interested, I did a study on the Eurasian Union, and I'll put another one on the 90 years, when I, as I mentioned. So I'll put some copies here. The chance to waste some time on a long weekend. Look, I think Abkhazia and the Eurasian Union, there's two aspects. One is the purely legal one. And there, inside the Eurasian Union, everyone is stuck, both on the Septian question, but also on the Nagorno-Karabakh question, where no one wants to recognize these regions as independent states, and not even Belarus, let alone Kazakhstan and the others. So you cannot legally integrate Abkhazia. You cannot legally, because of the Eurasian Union member states, no one recognizes them except Russia. So you legally you cannot do it. Now, in practical terms, they're not really isolated from Russia either, right? The flow of goods and people is there, it's happening. I never crossed the Russian-Abkhaz border myself. It's illegal under Georgian law, and I try not to do illegal things. So I don't know how the situation is there, but what is pretty sure is that it's much more relaxed than it was 10 years ago. So, you know, so in legal terms, you cannot integrate Abkhazia. In practical terms, I'm not sure to what extent that's a major issue that prevents the flow of goods between Abkhazia and Russia, or the flow of people. So it's not a major practical, it doesn't, you know, solve any major practical issues. And we know that there is smuggling between Abkhazia and Turkey, and even some, I heard stories in Abkhazia of, you know, unauthorized cargoes with and exchanges with Romania and Bulgaria, for example. I know that, you know, 80% of the supposedly Abkhaz wine exported to Russia is actually rebuttled Moldovan wine. So, I mean, there is something there which is not just Abkhaz Russian, but And we have the same issue, just we started on Nagorno-Karabakh and the guarantees for territorial integrity under the Collective Security Treaty Organization, right? Where basically the question for Armenia is, if there's a war over Nagorno-Karabakh, is Russia going to respect its commitment under our alliance, the CSTO, to protect our border? And what the Russians say is that we protect your border, or we internationally recognize Armenia, but it doesn't include Nagorno-Karabakh. So, you know, the story here is that basically all of these Eurasian Union states and CSTO states, they are completely divided on the issues of how to tackle, integrate, or respond to trade or security issues around Russia. Plus, you have Kazakhstan, which, especially on Nagorno-Karabakh, is very closely working with Azerbaijan not to let the Nagorno-Karabakh thing be smuggled, be smuggled into the STO, CSTO. You want a diplomatic anecdote? So, you know, the EU launched this European Neighborhood Policy, 2004, the South Caucasus is involved in the European Neighborhood Policy. The EU discusses action plans with the neighboring states, which was like 30 pages of bullet points of things we will do to boost the relationship. So we do with, you know, Ukraine, Moldova, Georgia, and then we're at the time of negotiating the action plans with Armenia and Azerbaijan. It was, I think, 2006. At some point, in the preamble of the action plan, so what happened was that in the preamble of the action plan, the EU recognized the principle of territorial integrity as a guiding principle of the EU-Azerbaijan relationship. And of course, Azerbaijan really wanted that as part of the action plan. And actually, paradoxically, the reason this came onto the table was because Azerbaijan was flying, had two charter flights to North Cyprus. So Cyprus blocked the negotiations on the... And Azerbaijan is challenging the territorial integrity of an EU member state, Cyprus, by flying into North Cyprus. So we are blocking it. And then, as the Azeris and the Cypriots together actually implicitly agree that we will both support a reference to territorial integrity in the action plan. So the Greek Cypriots and the Azeris implicitly wanted to smuggle this guarantee of territorial integrity into the action plan. So this they became diplomatic allies. So they deblocked and relaunched the talks. So the talks were advancing, but here Armenia came up and said, hang on, we want a reference to self-determination in the EMP action plan. Otherwise, we're not signing the EMP action plan. And after a bit of back and forth, Armenia persuaded the EU to have a reference to territorial integrity. So if you go to the EMP action plans with Azerbaijan and Armenia, you'll see that the EU to Azerbaijan says, you know, territorial integrity is great. And to Armenia, it says self-determination is also great. And that's, you know, the story behind these contradictory approaches to...
No, that's, I like your jokes and anecdotes. They definitely highlight some of the issues we were talking about. You were able to touch on the Eurasian Union territorial integrity in the dimensions of international law there. Is there anyone else in the panel who wants to react on any of these issues or to comment on ideological divides?
I'm sorry, your question was not original because all your journalists love this question and I would be neither original. And I'm saying that once you're appealing to international law, you can also appeal to international case law on recognition of the states like East Timor, Kosovo, and so on, South Sudan. So it's just like international law is a huge mess, and it's going to be a huge mess for a long time yet. And I won't appeal to you, to these two unless like it's the only place to do. Thank you.
Great. I see we can take another round of comments or questions. I saw you had your hand there.
Hi.
Sure, to speak loudly. It's easier because I have a microphone, but
okay,
you'll have
I'm
to speak.
Question. The first comment would be regarding the by Mr. LEYLEKIAN. So basically, Mr. LEYLEKIAN asked, what is the difference between Greece and the so-called de facto states? I would say that general is not about dependence. The notion of state is about representing the objective, being able to represent the objective national interests of the nation. So, for instance, if it was within the national interest of Greece to leave the European Union, they would be able to do that. But if it is, for instance, within the interest of the Nagorno-Karabakh to pick Azerbaijan over Armenia and to just to like integrate to the energy projects and just to the Silk Road project to develop better, or for Abkhazia and South Ossetia to join the CFTA over Eurasian Union, they do not have that choice. They cannot doing that. So basically, those entities do not represent the national, the objective national interest. So you cannot basically compare Greece or any kind of state entity with those entities. Secondly, what's the problem about de facto states? Taiwan is essential for geopolitical clash, like militarization on a constant basis, on a permanent basis. So like, and it is a major impediment for the think we should accept the status quo on maintaining the state of de facto, maintaining the de facto states. Secondly, I would just remind kindly that the main reason for human rights violations in Armenia is the exploitation of the discourse of conflict in both the countries. So actually the conflict is one of the major factors contributing to the human rights violation. So maybe it should be more rational to deal with the conflict of those countries for European Union, rather than just demanding them to improve their situation. And building on that comment, I just want to ask a question to Mr. Popescu. If it is rational for European Union to involve both the conflicts in Georgia and Armenia, or just to remain in Georgia and not involve in the conflict between Azerbaijan and Armenia, and why should be the difference? Like why the difference? That is my question.
Thank you for those very insightful comments and the direct question. There's a lot of meat to chew on there, but I think we can take. I saw your hand, and is there any others as well? Yeah, we'll take two more. And then we're gonna give everyone up here a chance to speak, just final words, and then we'll round off. Go ahead.
Okay, so my name is Barbara, and I'm a student at Central. And I would like to ask you, you developed a lot about a collaboration project in South Caucasus. And a lot of analysts, not a lot, but some analysts would argue that the multilateralism is a way for those three countries to go forward. And you have also mentioned the issue of trust. And do you imagine some kind of political or any other kind of cooperation that is feasible in the region that would enhance trust, for example, or try to develop their ties?
Very good and specific question. And we'll take the last from you, Wallace, yes? I want to remind anyone who didn't have an opportunity to ask a question here that there's a reception afterwards, which is a fantastic opportunity to continue these debates and discussion. So I hope you'll all come along to the reception as well. Go ahead.
Hello, my name is Murat. I'm a student in Paris. I'll rather continue on the issue of and my question will be precisely to Lenin. You mentioned in your talk that decide and take decisions independently, and it's important to have the initial dialogue. My question is, and you, by the way, you mentioned that the two governments must participate actively in this process, but my question is it possible to achieve some, let's say, considerable results without some compromise? I will give some examples. For example, if we consider the, well, I want to speak about the Azerbaijani policy because I come from Azerbaijan. If we, as far as I know, our side is ready to, let's say, to give rather high autonomy to the Nagorno-Karabakh territory within the Azerbaijani territorial integrity again. But we are for coexistence. I mean, we are for peace. I mean, we are open for that. What could the Armenian part propose, and what would be compromise Armenians agree on in this issue?
Fantastic.
Maybe just a small comment on Mr. LEYLEKIAN. You mentioned in the beginning of the talk the movement of the Masyeti people to the borders. Well, and you mentioned that it may have some hazard on the development of the relationships between Armenia and Georgia, if I'm not mistaken.
Yeah, I mentioned the fact that there have been projects supported by the European Union to relocate Meshratian Turks in southern Georgia, and that it increased the level of tension with the local Armenian, ethnic Armenian inhabitants of southern Georgia.
Okay. I get the point. I wouldn't like to get really deep into the history, but I'd like just to mention that historically in the South Caucasus, there were many people movements organized, and there were many people displacements. In many, let's say, demographical changes and political changes as well. So, I think it's important to take into account all these movements and all these changes.
You're right.
I think I'll probably just pass the microphone to you right away, because both the first and the last comment addressed you specifically.
I'll come with you, and I will continue with Mr. Polat and Molotov. You're right, you mentioned that there have been countless movement of population in the area, and that's the problem. The problem is that we built up, or we tried to build up, some nation state, as in Western Europe, whereas, as in the Balkans, the population were deeply intertwined and intermingled. And for instance, the biggest Armenian city of South Caucasus in 1990, well, it was Tbilisi. In Baku, as you know, there were an Armenian bourgeoisie and an Azerbaijani workers class, working class. And for instance, southern Armenia were deeply populated with Tatar people, so what we call today Azerbaijani people. So you're perfectly right to say this, and that's probably one of the sources of the problem. The problem is that when some powers try to move again, to take some historical alibis, to move again some population. There have been some massive clashes in the 20s, and you're right. So that today Armenia is more is the most homogeneous country in the region, because all the Azeris that were majoritarian people in Yerevan were expelled. But this is true also the other way around. So this is history. And the problem is that today some power tried to take the pretext of this history to move again some population, saying that they were here or they were there. Well, of course, we can come back to the, for instance, in 90, 100% of the official population was Armenian. So, okay. Another point to come to Mr. Moratla. I'm not sure that Greece today could leave so easily in the EU. And for instance, when you see the political debate today in France, and if, for instance, Marine Le Pen comes to the power, and the Trump told to make France leave the EU, that's not so easy. So when you say that the country, a true state, is preserving the national interest, I don't know what is the national interest. I know what is the national interest according to Marine Le Pen, or according to Mr. Macron, or according to Mr. Aliyev, or Mr. Sarkisian, by the way. What I want to say is that seen by the people leading Canada, they preserve their national interest, I mean the national interest of people living on that territory, by seceding from Azerbaijan, because they felt, and the last episode in 2016 gives some evidence that they were threatened. So that's the point, you know. And to come back to a previous question, when you talk about the territorial integrity and the right to self-determination, this is the United Nations Charter has these two principles, and we agree with this. They are equally presented, but it seems to me that the first principle, beyond this political principle, could be or should be, and is, by the way, the right to life, the right to live and dignity. And as far as long as some people based on an ethnic or religious group felt themselves right to live and to their own dignity, they may choose to secede from the hosting countries. And by the way, and to conclude, that's precisely why the Karabakh, after a first move to go with Armenia, finally decide to make just secession from Azerbaijan.
The conversation is just heating up, but we're officially over time as well. And I again want to encourage everyone to attend the reception afterwards, because I think we're getting into some very interesting conversation. There was a question directed specifically at Tatevik, and you mentioned that you would like to respond. I'd like to give the rest of you 1 minute max to respond on the, don't worry. So if you have some final comments or thoughts, you want to air very quickly.
Okay, so I'm just going to be brief and comment on the statehood discussion we just had here, because I think in the end there are like different, like for example we have like a lot of these small states inside Europe like Luxembourg or all that, who just like they cannot cope all what you probably said a state should do. So in the end it's about definition and it's about perception, not like only self-perception to perceive yourself as a state, but also if like at least the majority perceives a territory as a state, and in the end if you then capable of, I don't know, protecting your borders or opting out or into an international or supranational organization is not the point, but it's just about this legal definition in the end.
Okay, you have very little time, but you have some words here.
Okay. I'll start that Karabakh conflict, like people of Nagorno-Karabakh decided to secede from Azerbaijan not because of fun, because there were some demographical, economic, social, cultural issues. And they made their will. Like 98% leave Azerbaijan. And it was 82% of population. 82% of population. And it's not like my opinion. It's independent sources. You can look at them. So, and by the way, Nagorno-Karabakh, that's what I'm going to be in the in the borders of Azerbaijan because of these issues. And to be sincere, we are quite happy with this situation. We are not just happy with constant clashes on the borders and wounds of our soldiers, which is deeply, deeply painful for us. In these, like, in this situation, in the current situation, there won't be any, like, there can't be any negotiations on returning Karabakh to the Azerbaijan. Rhetoric is quite aggressive, and April's event just showed this for us once again. Thank you.
Nicu, final words very briefly.
Well, I think on this Greece independence question, look, I think if Greece decides to leave the Euro and the EU, half of the EU will not mind. And France will not invade Greece to break it apart for that. So Greece, it's costly for Greece to withdraw economically, but there will be security military retaliation. I mean, do you imagine French soldier invading Greece if they want to join, leave the EU? If Erdogan wants to leave NATO, he's welcome. which is not the case for Armenia. And even more narrowly, we have the precedent. The moment Armenia says, I do not want to sign the association agreement, you know what the EU did 3 weeks later? Adopted in the European Parliament the visa facilitation agreement with Armenia. There was no retaliation against Armenia. If Armenia or Belarus today would say, we are withdrawing from the Eurasian Union, you know, there are chances of war and the CSTO. And for sure you get massive economic retaliation. So I think in, under no circumstances, you know, all states are interdependent, but under no circumstances one can of withdrawal from the EU for a country like Greece, with, you know, the complete lack of the right to decide its foreign policy for a place like Abkhazia, or the cost of doing that for a place like Armenia. You know, it's like speeding. If I drive at 95 kilometers, I overspeed, but it's one thing. But if I drive at 150, it's different type of overspeeding, right? And just two words, if I have... okay, that's fine, that was...
No, I think that's where we have to round off here. And again, I encourage all of you to come to the reception and to approach the panelists here and discuss these issues further, because I think we could just be getting started. But with that, I'm going to conclude this this discussion here, and we'll be moving on to the next presentation. So please join me in a round of applause for all the panelists here.